ओम सदाशिव समारंभां शंकराचार्य मध्यमां अस्मदाचार्य पर्यंतां वंदे गुरु परंपरां. Okay, the topic today is, I think, the purpose of yoga and Vedanta, right? Let me start by asking a couple of questions. Why do you all get up early morning, twist your body into knots? Why do you do it? What's the purpose behind it? What's your purpose? Please tell me. I beg your pardon? Keeping? Okay, functionally fine. Okay, so for that you bend your body, stretch your mind. Yeah, yeah. Yes, ma'am. I'm sorry, I'm hard of hearing. Focus. Okay. Yeah. Okay, that's a good point. Yeah? Yes, sir.
Starting the day.
Okay. Yeah?
I feel good in my body.
To feel good and nice, yeah. Okay. If you look at this picture of yoga, most of us started off, including me, as a form of training your body. That's how we all started. Just to train the body, stretch it, some flexibility, some. It became what I would those days call a milder form of exercising. Okay? Mild. I mean, compared to going to the gym and lifting heavy weights, it was milder. Though not really, if you're looking at the fine tendon work that you all can do. Okay, it's much later. Okay, then some breathing exercises, pranayama actually, breathing exercise. That's all we knew as yoga. Yoga is much more than that. If you look at it, it starts with the yama and niyama, basically some universal ethics which cuts across religion, culture, etc. Some disciplines. Then the asana, pranayama, pratyahara. Pratyahara very often misunderstood as withdrawal from life. Then you have to be a monk. You have to be someone like me. Because pratyahara, and believe me, I'm not withdrawn from life. Yeah. So, pratyahara, okay, we'll look at it again. Then, dharana, focus. Most of our focus could do with some more focus. So, dharana, dhyana, the beginnings of meditation, and samadhi. Complete. When your meditative efforts are successful. Why? Why all this? Really, it's worth examining because, hey, we are intelligent people. We don't do just like that, things just like that. Unless what we have in a statement in India, we say, time pass, meaning passing the time. And I always look around people, do you have that much time on hands that you have time to waste, time to pass? Give me some of that time. I could do with a few more hours every day. So, why are we doing all this? There are a few definitions of yoga. The first one, of course, we consult as the main important one, Patanjali's definition. In the second sutra, Chitta Vritti Nirodha, mastery of the mind. Or if you are referring to the Gita, Samatvam Yoga Muchyate, balance in life is yoga. Or Yoga Karmasu Kaushalam, your personal sense of competency is yoga. or a very, nowhere have I used the definition yuj to join. Okay, that's not a definition. That is just some cooked up meaning. Or a very peculiar definition, dukkha samyoga viyogaha, separating from your natural association with grief, natural association with your existential grief, that is called yoga. If you look at all of them, the common thing that comes around will be mastery of your mind. Most important. Others are facets of the same. But for mastering the mind, why do you need all the way up to samadhi? And most of us are used to mastering the mind by doing things. No? Though there is no thinking class. I think nowadays there is a thinking class. Are children taught logic and how to think in schools? I don't know your school curriculum. In high school, are they taught something like that? Logic? No? Okay. So, you train your mind by thinking, by doing things. Why is all the samadhi? Because thinking you learn by living, by studying other subjects. You could have a separate thinking class also. It can help to be more logical, more focused. It can help. And what affects your thinking very often is what are known in yoga as kleshas, your emotional, psychological disturbances. So if you work on them, naturally your thinking improves. But the whole range of practices. Because the highest discipline of the mind, mastery of the mind, is when the mind stops thinking. It's easy to make the mind think in this direction or that direction. That's not difficult. What is this I hold in my hand? A pen? Now, here is where you think. So, a pen is used to write, draw, etc. This is normal use. This is your normal thinking. Now, think differently. Give me uses of this pen other than writing.
A weapon.
As a weapon. You're into martial arts, sir. Yeah, it's a ubiwasa stick. This and pressure points, you can kill somebody with it. Correct? As a weapon. Deadly use, yes. What else? Huh? Oh, yes. Tie your hair and... Oh, yes. It's a great clip. Yes? Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Stir a cup of tea.
Yeah. A cup of tea. To draw a circle. Ask the kids in school, kids. What all they do with a pen. Including the ink on the other person's back. It also writes... I mean, can you see, you can train your mind to think differently. It's not difficult. It's creativity. You look at what is and think of what can be, how different it can be. So to train the mind in thinking, it's easier. Stop thinking. Consciously, not unconsciously. Unconsciously we do. Consciously, stopping of thinking would be the highest discipline you can capable of. Therefore, chitta vritti nirodaha, the mastery of the mind, highest thing you're capable of would be to be in samadhi. It's not difficult, but it takes some time and effort. Not really difficult. It looks like, you know, very difficult thing. It's not. It takes some time, some discipline. And when does your meditative practice start in yoga? When does it start? It starts with your asana practice, with your practice of postures. Why? what do you all do? You put your body in an uncomfortable position, correct? Which yoga position is comfortable? In the beginning, it is uncomfortable. Ardha Matsyendriyasana. Even to say it is difficult. You put your hand and put your leg and then you test your body and then you hold this leg and you... okay. Then they'll say, breathe. Breathe, my lungs are compressed. What are you talking, breathe? And then, definition of asanam is sukham stiram. You should be comfortable and steady. What comfortable? When can I release it? It's uncomfortable. Yes, it's uncomfortable. And then a good yoga teacher will say, now be mindful, awareful, witness that. What are you feeling? Feeling stretched and crushed. What have you been feeling? But no, what are you feeling? Be awareful. Don't give in to that feeling. Yeah, all that is meditative practice. So your preparation for samadhi has started on the mat. Can you see that? This is yoga. The preparation for samadhi has started on your yoga mats. When you are doing a simple posture. Even a simple posture. What is that? Vrikshasana, standing like the tree. Simple. You just have to stand. On one leg, of course. Then, a little bit better. Close your eyes. And then, yes, be awareful. Without losing balance. Without losing balance. Great training for the mind. Great training for meditation. Yeah. So, to stand for 1 minute on one leg should be easy, no? 1 minute is easy. Even with eyes closed, it's only a minute. And be awareful. In fact, if you are centered and awareful, you will not lose balance. If your mind moves, your body will move. So can you see all the training for samadhi is right there. It starts here on the mat. So it's not just postures, it is not just exercises. Though that part is happening. What happens is, in all those postures, all your, what do you call, nadis, energy channels are being stretched or compressed. In the process, all the residual toxins, etc. are thrown out. That's why when you're doing yoga, you're supposed to drink a lot of water because it has to be flushed out of your system. Then when you do the pranayamas, the energy flows in. Actually, what are you doing? The main central channel is being in the, and pranayamas, you're flushing it with energy, filling it up so that it can flow all over. And then you can feel strong, powerful, centered. For what? Finally, samadhi, remember? Mastery of the mind. Yoga is about the mind. You use the body to handle the mind. That's why pranayamas. The pranayamas, many people don't practice. Actually, that's a very important part of the practice. If I was taking a yoga class, half the class will be postures, half the class will be pranayamas. Is that important? Yeah. Then the cold, etc. is not a cold if you are practicing pranayamas. Why? Your core is hot. When you do pranayamas, your core gets hot. And then if it flows through, there's not a problem. Where is the problem? It's warm and nice inside. Yeah. So it's not an issue. Students of Vedanta yogis require it because they're staying in isolated places without heating and things like that. Yeah, in the Himalayas. Some hut, some cave, something. It's cold. So you needed to do this. So your body doesn't disturb you and your studies. Then dharana, focus. Because that's focus is necessary of the mind. Yeah, then the samadhi practice, the practice of meditation. And meditation gets successful, it's called samadhi. All this to master your mind. Okay, fine. Mastery of the mind is yoga. Then what do we do with that mastered mind? You can do anything. Because you can use that mind in any field. How many of you heard about that rescue of those children, that soccer team trapped in Thailand? And their coach happened to be a former Buddhist monk. He taught them all meditation to calm them down. In this, you're strapped in a cave, water is rising, and he's teaching them meditation to calm the mind. Useful. Yeah, I'm glad that guy was there. Useful. Why? You're not panic. Because one of the main problems when you're trapped like that is panic. And if you panic, it can kill you, because you will make all the mistakes. So don't panic. Relax. Watch your breathing. Be contemplating. So you're calm in face of danger. Great thing to have. So yoga is this Ashtanga process, the eightfold process. Of course, now Ashtanga yoga means a particular form of dynamic yoga. Patabi Joyce, right? Isn't that what you all... How many of you practice Ashtanga yoga here? Practice, yeah. It's Patabi Joyce, right? He was a person from there, Mysore based. Yeah, but all yoga is part of the Ashtanga system, because the eightfold limbs, eight parts to it. All yoga is part of that. So all you need to do all this to be really Ashtanga. To be Ashtanga, eightfold, it's all this. So you get a mastered mind. So the purpose in yoga seems to be, by the very definition of Patanjali, mastery of the mind, predominantly. Now, as part of that mastery, you will talk about dharma, mega, samadhi, etc., where the latent capabilities of the mind is aroused. So you can do certain things. You're intuitive. All the siddhis that is mentioned. To an extent, all of them can be gained if you want it, including walking on water and all. People claim that. But why do I want to walk on water? If I want to go there, I would rather swim. Yeah, walking in water is useful only if I am working for Baywatch. Okay, then it is useful. Somebody is drowning there, you just run across the water, pick him up and come back. Great. Yeah. Otherwise, limited use. Yeah. People will think I'm a mutant or something if I'm walking there, especially in this dress. Yeah. And then they'll start getting scared of me, and this, and what is this character up to? So better not develop all those, you know, be normal. So, all this are actually incidental to the main practice. Getting those parts. In fact, in traditional schools, these practices are only taught to initiates. You know, any traditional discipline has what is known as a public art and a temple art. The public art, like how you find in yoga, asanas, this thing, are taught to everyone. The temple art is only taught to initiates. This is a deeper form. Initiate meaning those who are that committed into the study and practice of it. You have to prove that to your teacher. You have to prove that to your guru, literally. By that time, it is not no more instructor. Okay, at that level of practice, it is not more under an instructor. You are under a guru. So it is taught. But all this, you are doing so much to master the mind. Now, the mastery of the mind, is it a finite goal or an infinite goal? It's a finite goal, isn't it? It's one thing that you're doing. Can it be done by other systems besides yoga? It can be, yeah. A committed practitioner to yoga will recognize that it can be gained through other systems. My mastery of my mind came through a different field altogether, martial arts. In fact, the traditional martial arts in India and yoga have a lot of things in common. Why? Even some of the Chinese systems, because it went from India, Tibet to China, like Qigong, etc. Qigong is nothing but your pranayamas. Advanced pranayamas are Qigong. Little bit more advanced. Though, have you all heard of Tai Chi? Tai Chi Chuan? Many of you have heard of it. That's a dynamic form of yoga. It's a movement-oriented form. Movement-oriented, yeah. And the whole movement is also a martial art and a very effective form of martial arts. Yeah. Even though it looks so gentle and thing, but it takes a long time to master it. In boxing, you can start boxing in 3 months. You can use it. Karate, maybe a year. Tai Chi, 5 years. Before you can use it. That takes that long. Because you have to develop your energy systems, you have to... But all that. So, mastery of the mind can come in different ways. You're living a life with certain attitude. That's what is called karma yoga. That samatvam yoga muchyate and yoga karma su kaushalam, both are definitions from karma yoga. Because those attitudinal, you converting your whole life into your yoga. You're a yogi 24/7. I talked about it last time when I was here. Last year. At the festival, I talked about that thing. 24/7 you can be a yogi, but your attitudes are like that. Whatever happens in life, you have a sense of acceptance. You accept what happens and you focus on what you can do. Remember the previous talk? Jnana, Iccha, Kriya, Shakti. Three powers you have. The power to know, the power to desire, the power to act. So you do. Be proactive. Do the best you can. And result, whatever happens, accept. Because what are you going to do anyway? It's your baby. It's been dumped into your lap. You better accept it. Or you can struggle against it. So these attitudes, your whole life then gets converted to yoga. I don't have time for pranayamas, asanas, etc. Okay. Practice an attitudinal change. Work on the mind directly. Instead of using the body to work on the mind directly. That's karma yoga. So again you get that mastery. Now many people claim that yoga leads to moksha. Have you all heard this? To nirvana, to moksha. Many people claim that. Many teachers in public claim that. That is because of this samadhi, dharma mega samadhi. That samadhi experience is equated to moksha. Many of you were there in the previous lecture here, isn't it? That moksha cannot be an experience. All experiences are finite. Moksha is supposed to be freedom from finitude. So that cannot become an experience. An experience involves your subjectivity. What is this experience, for example? Look at it. There is objective knowledge. Sky is overcast. It is drizzling. Temperatures have dropped. This much is objective. Correct? All of us can agree to this much. It's so beautiful. It's too cold here. What beautiful. I wish it would stop. If you are used to hotter climes, you will say it's too cold, I want to stop. Or you will say, the heat is such, the coolness such a relief from the heat from where I come from. Can you see? That is a subjective component. So every experience has an objective component and a subjective component. So it's the subjective component that makes the experience varied for people. So the experience of samadhi is an experience, but you know nothing in there. You are dead to the world outside. Inside there is nothing because mind, etc. You have withdrawn from pratyahara, remember? You have withdrawn from the mind and everything. Now what is the experience there? I, nothing else. Maximum, it will be I. At the best. At the worst, it will be like deep sleep. A deeper form of sleep. Where you are awake, but at the same time you are dead to the world. In deep sleep also you are awake, you are dead to the world, isn't it? That much is common. That samadhi is not equal to moksha, I want you all to understand this well. You know, some years ago, I still have that class at a place called Chaupati in Bombay. It's a beach. Chaupati is a beach. So there used to be this person who used to be buried underground in that beach. He had two, three disciples with him, and he would bury himself, not the fun way that you do on a vacation, burying up to here. That is fun. Warm beach and you're burying up to here. No, this is right overhead, everything down, underground, 2 feet underground. That little air that is trapped is enough to keep him alive. Why? Because he's going into samadhi, otherwise you can't do this. Ordinary people going into samadhi cannot do this. You have to be really good at samadhi to be able to do this. In fact, when many people in Bombay tell me, no, samadhi is equal to moksha, I say, first you do this and show me. I challenge you to be this good in samadhi, and then you tell me whether you gain moksha or not. Why am I saying this? Because one day I said, I wanted to wait and see that man's reaction when he's coming out. Because samadhi, if samadhi equals moksha, what should he feel when he comes out? Anandoham, anandoham, I'm free, I'm liberated, hey, great. He should feel like that, quietly, if not, because samadhi equivalent takes some time. It takes some time to come out of it, yeah. If you're sitting in samadhi, yeah, okay, then you're still going to pull this, that. Great, and then you'll say, great. But this man comes out of samadhi, and there is a small cloth put in front of him. It's a form of panhandling, you know, called cloth. And people have dropped some coins, is that. And he looks at it, only 10 bucks. What is he saying? He's not saying great and anandoham and all. He's not saying that. He's saying only 10 bucks. Then he turns to me, I'm standing there. I'm another monk. Says, Maharaji, Swamiji, there are four of us all together. What are we going to eat in 10 bucks? 10 bucks Indian rupees. 10 bucks here also. Can four people eat here? I doubt you can. Even in the food court where the prices are cheaper than outside, for 10 bucks, four people cannot eat. What can we eat? So I said, come with me, I'll buy you all a meal. My turn. I met some monks, let me see. So I had a long discussion with them on this. And he said, that's true. The samadhi is a skill I have picked up. I had done some practice, etc. But that moksha and all, that feeling of fullness, limitlessness, etc. Not there. He was honest enough to admit, because professional courtesy. Okay. I'm a monk, he doesn't have to put any front in front of someone like me. We both know what it's about. So get this thing clear. Samadhi is not equal to moksha. Though samadhi is the highest form of that mastery. In my younger days, before I had become a monk, I also was under this impression samadhi is equal to moksha. And I had a very hectic lifestyle, in a sense of work and this, studies and work together. So I used to leave my home at 6:30 in the morning, after having breakfast at 6:30 in the morning. Why? Because after that, I don't know where the next meal is. I was a marine trainee. As a marine officer, training is hectic, so you don't know when your next meal is. If you're lucky, you'll have lunch. Otherwise, you'll have something at 4 o'clock, 5 o'clock in the evening. That's how it was. So, but I was into all this spirituality, and I wanted to. So, I used to practice meditation. I used to get up at 4 o'clock in the morning. If you attended that Ayurveda lecture, they would say, Brahma Murtha, the best time to meditate. Yeah, best time. I would get up, and sometimes I would go into samadhi. And in samadhi, there is no time. There is no awareness of time. How long are you going to remain in samadhi? If you fall asleep, when are you going to get up? If you fall asleep, can you time it? Unless you have an external alarm or something. Sometimes you put the alarm and that becomes some sort of a psychological timing and you will get up. But there are days when I am in samadhi, there is no time, and I got up, my mom would come and knock, knock, knock. What happened? You're not going to work. I said, what time is it? 7 o'clock. I said, no point. I won't be allowed inside. I lost a day. I had to make it up some other time. Then I used to keep an alarm clock, because can't afford to extend like that. And there are days when I don't hear the alarm clock, my mother hears it in her bedroom, comes and wakes, shakes me awake. The worst time to, worst way to come out of samadhi, to be shaken awake like that. Worst way, it is not healthy for the system. But she didn't know, she thought I'm wasting my time. Sitting down like that, closed eyes, trying to become some great rishi or something. What I'm trying to say is, at the end of that year, with many days going into, I didn't feel any different. And I had enough healthy self-esteem to say, nothing wrong with me or my Atma. There's something wrong in my understanding. So I had to look at the whole thing. That is why, in the Indian tradition, in our traditional ashrams and everything, where we are taught as initiates, yoga was preparing the mind. And for what? So that with that prepared mind, you can study the scriptures to gain moksha. Because look at it, you are so calm, your mind, you can think when you want, you can stop your thinking when you want. You can change your thinking into any line, any direction, different paradigms you can hold. The mind is trained to hold different paradigms in it. It's a great mind. With that mind, you're trying to get the knowledge of yourself as that infinite being. I'm having three talks in the three afternoons. I think one day the talk is earlier. Tomorrow the talk is a bit earlier. But day after is back to this time. So I'm having three talks, so the topics will overlap. So there I will clarify what the whole thing is about. So in the study, now what are you doing? Just studying is all theory. No. We are not studying a book called the Gita. We are not studying a book called the Upanishads. The teaching is about what you are. So we are studying ourselves. Which self? The self that is the body, you already done that in yoga. You know how the body functions, what it can do, what it cannot do, your strengths, your weakness, all that you already know in yoga. You have learned to manipulate your body into postures which other people can't do. Yeah. By the way, you can even get a six-pack abs with yoga, okay? So, I have seen people building a lot of strength with yoga. The practice is slightly different, but the same asanas are used. The same Surya Namaskaras are used, but different, to build strength. Yeah, and with the pranayama practice, you will have more strength, like how a martial artist has strength. Yeah. You can have, sand can go through bricks in this, right? Because there's a different type of strength. It's mind over matter strength. So, all that can be done. But so, your mind has been discipline trained. You're calm and centered. You have the focus. You can withdraw from things. Nothing can disturb you. You're a contemplative person. With that mind, you're trying to understand what is beyond all this. What is the truth of all this? Beyond means in the sense of what is the truth of all this? It requires a different type of mind. There are many people who listen to Vedanta, but it doesn't work. It doesn't seem to work in them because the mind is not ready. This body, you know you can manipulate it. Any person who's doing asanas can know this body is not you. That's why you use the word, I feel good in my body. If you notice the statement you made, he said, I feel good in my body. That means what? You are the one who is staying in this body. The body is not you. It is your experience. You know it well. I just have to point it out to make it clear. Because I can do things with this body. I can make this body do what I want. Okay, now it's aging a bit, so not so many things. But still, if I tell the body to do this, it'll do this. Good. I'm the master, not the body. Similarly, my mind. When I wanted to think, I can say think. Think differently. Think of other option. Okay, think. Stop thinking. Okay? If you can do that, you're really master, no? How many of us can really stop thinking when we consciously, when we want to? Difficult, no? In fact, I can make you think of things you don't want to think about. You have no choice. Right now, I'm going to utter a word, and I'm sure you have not thought about that until I say it. Camel. Is there a camel in your mind, in the image right now? You never even thought about a camel. Camel was the farthest thing in your thought in this weather. Camel is associated with heat and desert. Not here. Now look at it, the camel is sitting in your mind. Correct? Because you are feeling funny at the whole thing. It's camel, what a word he has chosen. Camel. Now, dismiss that. Forget it. This must be gone. So this is a yogi's mind. He cannot help thinking of the camel because that's an external stimuli and the mind responds to the stimuli. But if he wants to dismiss it, he can dismiss it. No more camel. Enough. Other things I'll think of. Focus back here. Otherwise, if your mind is not disciplined, you'll be thinking of camel, you'll be thinking of deserts, you'll be thinking of Lawrence of Arabia and all the whole thing. You'll be thinking of Iraq, Iran, all the problems and Trump and what all you can think of. That is a mind that's just going by itself. That's not the mind which is mastered. Forget all that. Be here. Okay, dismiss. Be here. The mastered mind. So, you are handling the mind. You are the master. The mind is an instrument in your hands. You are not the mind. The mind depends on you for its function. Most people find this difficult because they are not disciplined enough. Because they are not gaining that mastery, they think, what? I am helpless with my mind here. Mind says, do it, I go around. Mind wants to eat chocolate, I eat chocolate. Mind says ice cream. It's cold outside, but I feel like the taste. Okay. What do you do? There seems to be a helplessness in people with respect to their own minds, with their own desires. Hey, desire is a power. Only human beings can desire. Can a cow desire? Have a desire to eat an omelette? A cow cannot desire. You as a human being can desire. I've been vegetarian long enough, now an omelette for a change. Oh, good. I'm sure many people will be there in this camp, waiting to go home or on Monday morning at least to go and eat an omelette. At least minimum. Fine, your choice, your freedom, you have a desire. But if you are helpless with respect to that desire, then you are not the master, you are the slave. Similarly in other areas, I have the drive to work, do well in my work. That's drive, that's good. Or are you driven by your passion over? If you are driven, you are the slave, not the master. If you have a drive, then you are the master. This is mastery of yoga. When you have done this, you know the mind is your this. Your desires are in your hands. Yes. That means what? You are handling all of them. You are independent of all of them. What are you? The one who is aware of the whole thing. You are that conscious being who is aware of the whole thing. Then what is that nature of the I, the consciousness? What is that freedom from all limitation? Is that conscious a limited entity? Is that consciousness a product of your brain function? Is that consciousness independent of your brain function? Is it a consciousness, like I am saying, I have a soul, I have consciousness? Is it the finite Purusha that Sankhya talks about? Those of you have exposure to that? Or is it the limitless Brahman that Vedanta talks about? So if I have that yogi's mind, then all I need to do is I come to Vedanta, it's a walkover, it's easy. It's an easy thing. Vedanta becomes very easy. Many of you attended the morning talk on Vedanta in the space tent. Yeah. Well, that is, yeah, that is true. It's simple. Oh, yeah, that's correct. You'll see it. Why? Because up to that Sakshi, he made a difference there. Sakshi meditation as practice of mindfulness is different. Sakshi, what you are, is what you are being centered around in yoga, actually speaking. It is not an exercise of mindfulness because you are that awareful being and you are functioning as that awareful being. You are centered, it's called centered functioning. Yeah, it's centered functioning. The practice of meditation is different, that's where the mind is involved. Or you learn to drop the mind, that's also part of meditation. So in the practice of meditation, you'll to master the mind, you'll have two broad categories. One is focused awareness, one is diffused awareness. Many of you have done Tratak, in that focusing on the fingertip and all those things, or focusing on a flame, when you're focused on one thing. That is focused awareness. Now, what is diffused awareness? Diffused awareness, you are sitting here and you are aware of everything. Nothing in particular, but everything in general. You will want to experience that right now? Diffused awareness? Simple. Focus on your fingertip. Right now. All of you focus on your fingertip. This is the how you, or a pen or whatever you want. Just focus. This is Tratak. I mean, when you are focusing on that without blinking, etc. So when you are focusing on that, this is focused awareness. Now, don't look at the finger. Look at a place halfway in between. Halfway to your finger. You are not seeing the finger. You are not seeing the details of the finger. You will find that your awareness has expanded to include the whole room. You are not seeing anyone particular, but you know they are all around you. People are around you. People are this. Don't focus on the finger. In fact, drop the finger now. And just be in that diffused awareness of everything. And now, the mastery comes. When you do, we can do the focus. I focus on you, at the same time my awareness diffused. Can you see that? Focused, at the same time diffused. If you can do that, you have mastered your mind again. You know, in Mahabharata there is a story of this great warrior, Arjuna. Many of you may have heard about it. Gita is a dialogue between Arjuna and Krishna and all that. So when Arjuna was a kid, kid means really kid, when he just started his learning of martial arts, okay, because he's a prince born, warrior, he has to be a warrior, just on. So, to cut the, I mean, I can go on about his training, it's huge learning from that, but okay, to cut the long story short, after 1 year of training, they have not fired a single arrow, bow and arrow training, they have not shot a single arrow for a year. Then Drona, the teacher, comes and says, okay, he counts people one by one. There is a bird and you are supposed to shoot the eye of the bird, 100 yards away. Ask them, what do you see? Oh, the tree, the branch, the bird, don't shoot. No one shoots, no. Arjuna comes forward. What do you see? The bird. What? The eye of the bird, sir. Shoot. Drona doesn't even bother to check the target. Why? He knows the mind has reached there, the arrow only has to follow. Total focus. Okay? Total focus, he sees the eye of the bird, nothing else. Now when this Arjuna is grown up and he's fighting a battle, can you afford to have total focus like that? You don't know where the attack is going to come from, no? Death can come roaring out, roaring from any side. from any direction. You're fighting with one guy, but somebody else can be attacking you at the same time. From any direction. So what do you need there? Focus on the immediate opponent. Diffused awareness everywhere. It's part of the warrior training. Though you may never want to be a warrior. But it is part of that training. I'm familiar with both the backgrounds. I have some background in martial arts. So this type of martial arts, you know, more advanced, not just punching and kicking. That is easy. That's what we call donkey's work in India. Donkey's work, punching and kicking. Oh, you need to do more than that. That is basic. Punching and kicking is basic. What's the big thing about that? Even a donkey can kick. In fact, there is a kick in karate called donkey kick. Yeah. Because we have to learn from them how to kick. A giraffe's kick can kill a lion. Can you imagine a giraffe kicking can kill a lion? Break his shoulder bones? The impact can carry forward to the lungs and finish it off. You have to learn from them how to kick. Yeah, so that focus and diffused awareness. So that when you do all these things, look at what your mind is. The mind can be focused on the self, and it can hold the infinity of the self within. It can understand that. It can get resolved into the infinity of your own being, into the limitlessness of your own being. But that step is taken in Vedanta. So the purpose of Vedanta is this final step. The teaching of what exactly I am. I am that limitlessness. I am that Ananda. That is the teaching in Vedanta. So that is the purpose of Vedanta. Vedanta teaching is not to be a better human being. Many people come and tell me, Swamiji, after I started studying Vedanta, I become a better human being. Why do you need Vedanta to become a better human being? Be a human being, you'll be a better human being. Get some humane qualities in you, you're a great human being after that. Why do you need Vedanta for that? Breaking your head on all these texts, which are all in Sanskrit, why do you need to do that? Just to become a better human being? There are 1,000 other ways. So better human being is not Vedanta. Yeah. So you prepare the mind through yoga or allied disciplines. Then you come and you live your life well, because now life which was a burden before or which was a struggle before, no more a struggle. Why? You have this focus, you have this. Life is easy. You can tackle whatever life throws at you, you can handle. Why? Because you have a mastered mind. You're a competent person. You can pick up any skill. I don't know anything about this. So what? You know how to think. You know how to focus. You know how to act decisively. Think clearly, feel strongly, act decisively. What is the skill you can't pick up? Tell me. Which skill you can't pick up? If you can think clearly, there's no skill you can't pick up. You've mastered difficult skill of tying up your body in knots. Of holding your breath so long that others are getting worried. Yeah, you have mastered such difficult skills. You know, advanced pranayama practice, you almost stop your heart with the pressure of built up and the health, the kumbhaka that you do, the breathing that you hold in, you almost stop your heart. If you have mastered this skill, computer skills, what's so difficult? What is difficult about that? Engineering skills. What's the difficulty of picking up that? Your mind is a honed instrument. There's no skill you cannot pick up. Therefore, where is the challenges of life a problem for you? Okay, if you're a great yogi, relationships can be a bit of a problem. You know why? The other person says, you always do this, you're never this thing, I've been telling you 10 times. And here you're calm, peaceful. Okay. That can be a bit of an issue, yes. So you have to learn to be a little bit more empathetic, which you will be. If you have mastered your mind, some empathy will come. Oh, I'm so sorry. You know how to do it. All of you know about relationship. What is necessary to be done because somebody is angry. But you're calm, you're centered. So somebody is attacking you, you can still be loving enough to hold the person in a hug. Not physically, emotionally. Verbally. Physically, she'll pull you up, push you apart, isn't it? You think, what is this? I'm angry with you. Yeah, yeah, okay. We all know this. That life teaches you, don't worry. But you're calm and centered enough to understand the person is upset and angry. Come on. I'm not feeling threatened by it because I'm calm. Therefore, I know to be empathetic so that the person feels that I have understood. Not that you can truly understand everything, but okay, some amount. Enough for the person to feel, okay, I'm understood. Yeah, that much of empathy is there. Good enough. So at least the person is willing to clarify if you're not understood. And therefore, yeah. Or the kid comes home from school, throws the bag on the stupid school. I don't want to go back. How can you say that? Schooling is so important. If you don't finish school, what will you do? You're a yogi now, relax. Uh-oh. Calm, peaceful. Kid looks angry here. Now you'll respond empathetically. Boy, you really bugged. Looks like someone really bugged you in school. Like to talk about it? Yeah, mom, you know what? The kid will pour out. If you start giving a big dialogue, speech to the child of how schooling is important, that kid will go and say, stupid mom, doesn't understand anything. And by the time the child is a teenager, will stop communicating. Whereas if you respond like this, wow, hey, dad is old, fuddy-duddy, but he's cool enough to understand all this, yeah? For which teenager, dad is cool? Or mom is cool? No, no one is. But he understands, yeah, that's good. My dad is different. He'll say that. Or my mom is different. Why? Because you're calm. You can respond with what is necessary. So life is easy to manage. Life is easy to manage. So yoga is not about running away. That you can do if you want to. That you can do. But yoga is about being, life is easy. Karmasu kaushalam, competency. I'm competent enough. Then with that relaxed mind, when you come and listen to what Vedanta has to talk about, the words, your mind is trained now to go along with the words. I'll give you a glimpse of Vedanta teaching. When you are saying it is pointing out the truth, etc. Let us say, of course, instead of full moon on Tuesday, let us say it was no moon. The no moon. So the new moon started after that. So now that's only the third day. It's a small crescent. And I'm saying, ah, how beautiful is the moon. And my friend is standing by and says, moon, what moon? He can't see the moon. What moon? I say, you see that lake there? Yeah. Do you see the tree to the right of it? Yeah. Hey, but I'm asking you about the moon. What are you talking about the tree? Relax. Just let your mind come along with me. Okay? That's the tree. Then, can you see that branches forking that side? Yeah. Now look just above that branch. Oh yeah, beautiful. Now in that appreciation of the beautiful crescent moon, is there the lake and the tree and all that thing? Gone. Only the moon is there. Similarly, when you come to a Vedanta class, that's how you listen. You start with the body, etc. You're independent of the body, independent of the mind, independent of your memories, your knowledge, your emotions, you know this. Then what are you? That awareful being that's aware of all this. And that awareful being is nothing but pure consciousness. Ah, it's like seeing the moon. Ah, that's true. After that, what can you do? After that, what is to be done? Let's go and have a cup of coffee. It's cold day. I mean, after that, what? Be normal as anything else. You see, you know. Of course, there are nuances to be worked on. There are nuances. I have not this thing. That I will do on the third day, on Sunday, when I am talking about what moksha is about. This is setting the base. This is setting the base. So any questions or clarifications on this up to now? I know it's a rainy day, some of us has to drive a long way and things like that. Okay, so start with questions. Any questions you have? Shoot. On anything, what you have talked today or even any other thing that you have heard somewhere and you want to clarify, fine. If there are no questions, we can all go for dinner, okay? I'm sorry, I'm hard of hearing, so you'll have to speak up a bit.
Is there any way that in maybe a paragraph that we accidentally came late could get a general gist of it for the next two?
I'm sorry, can someone repeat that?
What will you talk about for the next
2 days? Tomorrow, I'll be talking about what are the practices in yoga and Vedanta. And on Sunday, I will be elaborating on the idea of moksha or freedom. That liberation, that you talk about nirvana, all these are terms that are used. What exactly it is? I'll be helping people, since all of you are into yoga, etc. I'm sure all of you will get an insight into that, right? In the class, in this session itself, in these three sessions, you'll get an insight into that. Because you all have better minds than the people who come to me in public, because you all have been practicing at least the asanas part of it, if nothing else. So that much of calmness is there. And then this location is so good, it helps you to be makam. So that's what. Yeah.
So I've heard that there are different types of samadhi.
Different types of samadhi?
So could you just elaborate?
Yeah. Two broad categories they'll talk about. One is samadhi. Now, what is samadhi? There are various explanations, but the simplest one would be yatra manaha samadhiyate, where the mind is resolved. Okay, so two broad categories are there. One is called savikalpa, sabijam in yoga sutras, or nirvikalpa, nirbijam in yoga, nirbijam in yoga sutras. What is it? Savikalpa samadhi is what you practice. You know, there is an attempt of resolving your mind. So, what you are normally practicing, okay, some focus exercises, dharana, focusing exercises, some quietening the mind exercises, japa, dhyanam, etc. So, the chant, etc. that you do, that helps, that is dhyanam. Then, savikalpa samadhi is this meditative practice, when you are attempting to resolve that mind. But there is always an attempt. That's the only thing you can practice. When the attempt is successful, you call it nirvikalpa or nirbija. These are two main categories. When the mind is resolved completely, that's nirvikalpa. When the mind is when the attempt is being made, it is called savikalpa. Two main categories. Other is which yoga talks about dharma mega samadhi, the cloud of dharma. Meaning you are getting all the beautiful powers, etc. So that happens. Okay. The practice of yoga and this is also energy work. When you are two types of energies, one is the universal energy that is there. Like here, there's a lot of water energy now. And it's beautiful. It's very beautiful to do a lot of calming practices. It's easy to slip into samadhi with the calming practices here. Or it's a bright hot summer day. That's all the yang energy, the strong energies, the soft and the strong energies. Outside, generally outside is more of the softer. Softer doesn't mean less powerful, is more powerful. Okay. What is softer, water or stone? Softer. Water, actually. What is stronger, water or stone? Water, because it'll wear away the stone. Can you see? The soft and the yielding can very often overcome the hard and the unbending. Yeah? The soft and the yielding can very often overcome the hard and the unbending. This is a principle of the behind all soft martial arts. Like Tai Chi, Judo, Jiu-Jitsu, higher forms of Kalari. All this is the principle behind it. The soft and the yielding can overcome. So, the universal energies appear softer. They're more powerful, but they appear softer. The internal energy that you cultivate with your pranayamas, etc., are the harder energies. Why? You cultivate the harder energy inside so that your meridians, etc., are clear, and the natural energy that flows in, more of it can flow in. Why? Because your nadis, what they call meridians, energy meridians, all have become strong and powerful. So they can absorb in more. It's like a puppy going and drinking water from that, or an elephant going and sucking in the water out. You know, that much of difference can be there. So when you do these practices, what happens is the energy rises in your system. So when the energy rises, certain things like intuition, etc., grows into you. You know, very natural for it to happen. As a byproduct, all this happens. Fringe benefit, all this happens. Yeah, really speaking, it happens as a fringe benefit. We are taught to ignore all these things. Forget it. Why do you want to read somebody's mind? Your mind is problematic enough. You want to read somebody else's mind also, which is more problematic. Then you're confused. Is it that person's thought or your thought? Don't get into all that. So we say ignore it. So, but all these things, it's there. So this is called Dharma Megha Samadhi. These type of practices, your mind is absorbed, mind is also doing certain things, which helps you get all these energies. Yeah. So that is the 2-3 basic types of samadhi, broad categories. Now in the Samvikalpa Samadhi, the practices, etc., there can be 1,000 varieties. I have seen 1,000 varieties. There can be more. I have dabbled and seen how it is. 1,000 varieties. Yes. So this is a broad categorization of what samadhi is. Yeah. Yes, sir. Sorry, my hard of hearing.
Is Sahaja Samadhi the ultimate goal of Vedanta?
Now, what is Sahaja Samadhi? When your mind is naturally contemplating, you are calm and centered, whatever happens. That is called Sahaja means natural. So your mind is, when you know the truth, and the mind is never away from the truth I still have to unfold. You know, that consciousness being everything. When the mind is steeped in that knowledge, you don't have to practice meditation. See, in the beginning you have to do some meditation, etc., even after you are exposed to the truth, to make it a part of your life. At what Sarva Priyananda was saying, to make it real for you. You know, make it real. So to bring it into your life. Because it's something new you have learned, you are not yet at home with it. You are not yet at home. So to make it at home, you practice a meditation on it, on what you have understood. After some time, what? You are at home with it all the time. Like I studied under a great teacher in Rishikesh. He is called Harahara Tirtha. Sadhu names are a bit funny names, you know. He was Harahara Tirtha. So somebody asked him, and he was an old man that time already, huge, 3 times my size, and he would be sitting in one place and teaching. Batches will keep changing, right from morning 6 o'clock is the first class. Batches of students will keep changing. He is sitting in one place. No tea break, no coffee break, no loo break, nothing. Up to 11 o'clock, he is just sitting there from 6 in the morning and teaching. Students come and go, batches change. So somebody asked him, Swamiji, how many hours do you meditate? He looked at him. Says, Beti means like daughter. It's an affectionate form of address in Hindi, in our language there. He says, why are you putting this disturbance called meditation into my mind? He is at home with the truth, is never away from him. Why do you need that? Why are you putting this disturbance called meditation into my mind? So that is Sahaja Samadhi, you know, when your mind is never away from the reality, never away from the truth. You are the calm center in the storm of all activities. Activities are happening, things are happening, but you are at peace and fine. Yeah. How do you find that? How do you go?
What is a natural energy?
Tomorrow's talk, sadhanas. Because it's a huge topic. Yeah, I'll deal with it. I will not escape that. But the sadhana part of it, no? Yeah. Between? Between?
Samadhi.
Samadhi, yeah?
And Isvara Pranidha.
What?
Ishvara,
I didn't get the second one.
Ishvara Pranidhanam.
Good question. Very good question. Ishvara Pranidhanam comes as part of Yama Niyama. To recognize the play of Ishvara in your life and have a sense of acceptance. That is called, another word for it in India is bhakti, devotion. you know, that devotion, because it gives you the ability. Okay, it is, this is very cultural. You came for that puja that day, yesterday?
No.
No. Okay, we had a small puja. After that puja, some sweets were distributed. Nobody called it a laddu or a jilebi. They all called it prasada. Now, prasada can be anything. It can be a fruit. It can be a laddu. It can be a jilebi. It can be a chocolate. It can be an ice. It can be anything. Anything offered to the Lord and comes from the Lord is prasada. So, when I have the sense of devotion, say, hey, I acted the natural Lord's laws, which are the Lord. Because remember the previous class, she was talking about everything is a manifestation. So the manifestation, the physical laws, including gravity, etc., all this are a manifestation of Ishara. Ishara pranidhanam. Therefore, the result is what? Prasada. Success, prasada. Failure, prasada. In between, prasada. Today, prasada was laddu. Nice, great, sweet. Eat it. Success. A simple fruit. Oh, okay. Small flower. All right, nice. Sometimes in some, this thing, the prasada is ashes. It's not called ashes. It's called vibhuti, glories. Why? That ashes are formed because of the glory of the Lord. So what happened? I did a lot of things. What did I get? Nothing. Everything. Ashes, prasada. Put it on. So can you see what attitude it gives you? It sets me up for being free of that self-judgment of success and failure. That self-criticism. Gone. I'm a person who accepts things that are there and do what I can about it. Great mind. Ishara Pranidhana. That mind to go into Samadhi is easy. Can you see? All these are preparations to go into Samadhi. And Samadhi itself is a preparation to understand the truth. Great system. The whole thing is put in place. So at the end of it, you are a free person, joyful, either simple, because you are visiting a funeral. You are not going to say, because you are joyful, you know. Brahmavidananda, Anandaha. But I am not. I am not going to behave like a grinning gorilla there. They are sober, this, that, etc. Or a class, okay. Sometimes joke, sometimes... having a cup of tea with her friends. Okay, crack all the jokes you want. You know, you're fine. Anyway, Ananda, you are right through. With the serious situation, you are empathetic to the pathos of that situation. You are Ananda, but you are empathetic to the pathos of that situation. In that situation, people have lost someone. It's serious. To the pathos, you are alive too. Or you are roaring with laughter, but you are Ananda all the time. Yeah. That is when the samadhi is successful and you are free from this. That process, etc., I'll talk about tomorrow. And the end, how the whole thing works. Third day, I have 3 days, a lot of time. Yeah, 3 days, a lot of time. Any other questions or clarifications? It's purely, now it's up to you all when you want to stop it. Beyond seven, I'm talking about within seven, it's up to you all. Because I have stopped a few minutes early thinking of the, some of you are to travel. Rains, okay. Yeah?
Is manifestation prakriti?
Is?
Is manifestation.
Yeah?
Prakriti.
Prakriti, yeah. You will call it. Prakriti is a name given. Nature. So, prakriti, maya, avyaktaha, all these are names given to what can help the manifestation. The manifestation as well as what helps the manifestation. These are the terms used. So, cloth would be the reality here. The shawl, it's got a different word in India, but let's call it shawl, is the manifestation. Because cloth can be in any form. Cloth is a reality. This kurta, this is called a kurta, a guru shirt. It had a name, guru shirt. Because all gurus wear just like this. A guru shirt is a manifestation. But cloth is a reality. Remove the cloth, there is no guru, there is no shirt. Yeah, exactly. Same like the golden chain. Same as the golden chain. In fact, the whole world is manifestation. I will unfold that more in the next 2 days. I will do that. Yeah, she'll also do that. So we are going on parallel tracks. The focus here is a blend of yoga and Vedanta. That is only Vedanta. So we'll go like that both ways. Any other questions or clarifications you want? Beg your pardon? Someone said something? No? Oh, okay. Yeah.
Why are all the teachers' names end with Ananda?
That is, we are supposed to have recognized the truth, okay? So all sadhus will be called Ananda. Okay, this is a little cultural thing. All sadhus are called Ananda. But you need to differentiate one Ananda from another Ananda. Because you have two forms. Ananda is limitless. But you have two forms. So some word will be given. That word generally will be unfolding the self, unfolding the reality. Like I am Brahmavid. So the one who knows that knows what Brahman is, knows the truth. So the knower of Brahman is Brahman. So Brahmavid Anandaha. He is Swatmanandaha. The Ananda of knowing yourself. It doesn't differ much. But the name sounds different. Meaning-wise, not very different. But it sounds different, so you can identify. Oh, this is this, this is that. Yeah. Of course, we all have our nicknames with people. That's okay. Yeah. That nicknames are fine. That's part of the fun. Yeah. So that, and Saraswati is a surname. Brahmavidananda Saraswati. Because there are 10 surnames available in Saraswati. Your surname will identify which is your center. Like Saraswati, Bharati, etc. is from Sringeri. Puri, etc. is from Puri. Parvataha, Vanama, etc. Tirtha, etc. So all this from the four different mathas that the Shankaracharya set up. That just for identification purposes. Doesn't matter. Not that there is any. See, the Indian sannyasi is different from a monk. A monk has a monastery to take care and protect, and he is controlled by the monastery also. He has to obey those things. An Indian sannyasi is one person under the sun. No controls. No support. Support is whatever the society does for you, because you are teaching them and they are your students, you will support, whatever. That's it. One person under the sun. There's only a vertical thing about you and your guru. That's it. That's the only thing that is there. And your guru bhais, we call your brothers. Like Swatmanandji and I. We are guru bhais. We are students of the same teacher. So, we are guru bhais. We are brothers. But he's an independent person. I am an independent person. We all do our own thing. In the way we want it. No controls. Total freedom. Great way to be. But then, it's not only with great power comes great responsibility, with great freedom also comes great responsibility. You have to do. You're responsible for everything that you do, say, do, everything. Yeah. Yes, ma'am. I'm sorry, I'm not understanding.
The significance of the color orange
there. Ah, the orange color. Ah, treat it as just a uniform. Okay. This is just a uniform. The orange color of fire, the tent, the fire. Why? Because it stands for knowledge. So it was a uniform worn. Here is a person who has the spiritual knowledge. So anyone who wants to go and learn from him, it is a declaration. Like, you know, here is a policeman. You can go to him if you are in trouble. May not also, but whatever, he can. So similarly here, the person, if you want the spiritual knowledge, this is a guy you can approach. So it was like a uniform.
And if you're not in uniform?
It is not a?
If you're not in uniform,
people still approach you. It's some sort of a thing. It's like, I equated it. It's not exactly the same. Yeah. It's that color. The color stands for that. Yeah. Saffron color for knowledge. Therefore, people could identify. These are the people who are wearing saffron. So, they're all into this.
Do you always wear the uniform?
Huh?
Do you always wear the uniform?
As a income? No. I wear orange all the time, yeah. All the time we are in. No, it's a. I don't use any other color, and believe me, it's a freedom. You know why? Whether it's a wedding or a funeral, I can go like this. Okay. So women may get a bit bored with it. Okay.
So if there's the Swami attaining knowledge and another. Vedanta is to see the truth, is what is Atman? If you, does that mean you have attained Atman?
Not sure. If you take sannyasa, what it means? Okay, now I can give you any answer. It'll have to be a matter for belief. You know, for you. Do I know what I'm talking about? Yes, definitely.
No.
Then, you said Atman, you said.
Yeah, what is
the Atman?
Atman,
this.
If you see the truth,
yeah. How do you take the Atman?
Have you attained
Atman? How I attained it? How I attained the thing? Or have I gained that knowledge?
When you say you see the truth,
yeah.
Does this mean that you have attained Atman?
Yeah, it's the same. When you say the word truth, Atman, Brahman, all these are synonymous. They're used to indicate some standpoints. The truth, the reality, then you're talking about the whole world. Atman, you're talking about yourself. Brahman, you're talking again of the whole thing. They're only standpoint differences, but they all mean the same. So, whether you're a Brahmavid or an Atmavid, meaning is same. Meaning is same. Yeah. Or, if you're someone who knows the truth, Satyavid, there can be a monk name like that, Satyavidananda, the meaning will be the same. It all names are different to indicate different things, but same.
So, like Ananda, you know, in Buddhist teachings, you have a Bodhisattva, which there are many. Is that similar?
There are some differences, yeah.
So
there are some differences, but essentially, when there's somebody asked in the morning, Buddha talked about Shunya, that was an interpretation. Buddha didn't talk about the self, he maintained a silence. See, Buddha never created Buddhism. Buddha was a monk like all of us.
Yeah.
He didn't have one single teacher. He went to different people. He would learn. He would discuss. Then he would go back, sit down and contemplate on it. Then he would come out, go learn from people, go back, contemplate. This was the process. And one day it all clicked for him under the Bodhi tree. That clicking again, I will clarify later. In the next 2 days, I will clarify. It clicked for him. Then, see, he was already a king. A king has renounced and become a monk. Just imagine Bill Gates coming into India and taking sannyasa. What will happen? He will get 10,000 followers immediately, right? Bill Gates has done it. There must be something about it. So similarly, a prince doing it, so a lot of people. Now, everyone who is coming to him are not yogis with prepared minds and things like that. So he put them on simple things. The Eightfold Path, which is identical to three verses in the sixth chapter of the Gita. Identical. Right food, right sleep, right attitude, right work, all that thing. You know? Same. Why? Let them get ready first. Let their minds be ready, then we'll talk about the truth. So whenever he asked about the truth, he kept quiet. Now, silence can be interpreted. Either I can say he doesn't know the truth, which should not be fair knowing him, what he was. Or I can say he didn't have the means to communicate. Or I can say he didn't want to communicate, he didn't think people were ready for it, which is the most likely answer, or which I lean towards. Okay? Or someone interpreted, oh, that means there is nothing. Shunya is the truth, nothingness is the truth. It's interpretation, because silence can be interpreted. Ask your teenage kids, they're very good at it. Mom, can I have another chocolate? Your mom keeps quiet because she's upset. She has told him no 3 times already. He didn't say no. I can go and eat. he didn't say she's upset. I better not. So can you see the interpretation? Silence can always be interpreted. Words can also be interpreted. Silence can also be interpreted. So that's what happened in that case. So Buddhism was found 500 years after Buddha. Nagarjuna wrote the first book. The first writer was Nagarjuna, 500 years after Buddha. A long time at GAM. So, like you were saying, I also interacted with a lot of Buddhist monks. In fact, I learned Tai Chi Chuan he was a lama, his student, you know, the parampara, it was this thing, Lama Shewang Mignor Nobu, so Tibetan monk. He was a very high person in the hierarchy. He came to India along with the Dalai Lama. So when talking with these monks, they all said, you know, it is not Shunya, it's a reality which is non-conceptual, which you can't conceive of in terms of a glass of water, a flower, these are all conceptual realities. This reality is non-conceptual, which is not actually Shunya, which we have a word for it called Nirguna, without any concepts. The reality which is Nirguna, without any concepts. Because mind moves in concepts. Now, what is behind all the concepts? You can never have a concept. This is a kurta, it's a concept based on cloth. So, concepts mean there is a reality behind it. So, the absolute reality, the ultimate reality, was called non-conceptual Nirguna, which was translated as Shunya. So, many of the modern Buddhists, when they have this interaction, they are happy with the word non-conceptual reality. Because not nothingness. Because they'll say it is nothingness, but it fills up the whole world. How can nothingness fill up the whole world? Nothingness is nothing. Can you see? They use expressions like that. It is nothingness. It reflects everything that is. These are all Zen cons. Okay? It's like the stillness of the pond that reflects everything, that keeps nothing. But you're talking about nothingness. So it's not really nothingness. This is a non-conceptual reality. I'll explain that. What is the non-conceptual reality as part of that? Two more days I have. No? I'll explain that. Yeah. So what? Time to call it a day?
10 minutes.
Huh? 10 minutes. 10 minutes if anyone has questions. Or whatever. Next program is only at 8. Those who want to listen to them. Today is a dance program, right?
Yes.
Yeah. So this is one thing. I'm here every this thing. If you want to keep in touch, I have a website where some of these concepts are explained very simply. It's called vedicwisdom.in. Vedicwisdom.in. And I have a YouTube channel also where I put up some serious stuff, some funny stuff. Some funny stuff, some sequels to Capsular and the Monkey Story. All of you studied in school, some sequels to that. For my management training, I use some of these stories. You know, the hare and the tortoise, part 1, part 2, part 3, 3 sequels have been created. So those are the fun things I put up on the channel. It is called Arsha Vidya Foundation. The channel is Arsha Vidya Foundation. You'll find a link from the website also.
How are you spelling the YouTube?
Arsha, double A, R-S-H-A, Vidya, V-I-D-Y-A, Foundation. Arsha Vidya Foundation. So YouTube, there is some serious classes also they put up, recording, which is 1 hour long. Or these simple things, 3 minutes, 5 minutes also, I have some things. So those who don't have the, wouldn't want to listen to a long one. But something simple will be nice. So I got that also. So I have a series there, Introduction to Vedanta. 10-15 minutes cassettes of about five of them. So you get introduced to the whole idea. So that is one way. Yeah, and of course, probably next festival also I'll be here with the look of things. If the festival is on, then we'll so anyway, next 2 days I'm definitely on, so we'll see. God willing, weather permitting, everything will go fine. Okay. Okay, Om Tat Sat. Take care.